Well, hello and welcome. A panel of national experts has been assembled to articulate the historical context of an ongoing trillion-dollar scandal that has caused high internet prices and low-quality service, that is, no fiber-optic access to the internet for many homes throughout the United States, blocking disabled, low-income, minority, and tribal communities' access to jobs, education, health, and economic resources. Wireless is not a cogent alternative, lacking both in quality of service as well as safety to users. Los Angeles County and like regions throughout the United States will receive mere pennies, if anything, from BEAD dollars and other state government funded programs designed to close the digital divide. This despite representing the country's most lacking regions in fiber optic connectivity. Really excited today to have this esteemed panelist with Alice Stibbins and Odette Wilkins, Heather Hutto, and David Rosen, who will all be sharing their individual perspectives on what they see and what has happened. What we know is that there is a huge lack of accountability at all levels. So we'll start with you, Alice, and then we'll go from there.
Good morning or good afternoon, everyone. As Larry said, I'm Alice Stebbins. I'm here on this panel today because of my experience of 2.5 years as the executive director of the California Public Utilities Commission. Most of my references today is going to be speaking from a California perspective, just because that's where I did most of my regulating. I had a 34-year career with the state of California as a administrator, regulator, auditor, enforcer, forensic accountant, all the above. I was asked to come to the California Public Utilities Commission to clean them up. And their financial situation was not good. And what I mean by that is they didn't have any accountability in their accounting of the money that was coming in and going out, or was expected to come in. And so I was hired specifically to do that. And I did that. And after 2.5 years, I was fired from the PUC in September of 2020 because I reported $200 million that was uncollected by the Public Utilities Commission. I reported that to my commissioners. And by the way, I did go to court. I lost in court, but the important thing, especially for this panel to understand, is that the 12-person jury said that I did in fact blow the whistle and that I did report illegal state and fiscal practices at the PUC and that they did break laws and they did uncollect the money. Has anything been done about that? The answer is no. If I'd won the case, people would have been excited. The jury didn't know why I got fired. I think the important part is that of that $200 million, about $100 million or more was related to telecommunications. And that essentially means that the programs that the PUC oversaw, which included a program called Lifeline. Lifeline provides free telephone service and phones to low-income qualifiers. And it's a great program. However, it was not collecting the money it needed to collect from the telecommunications. The deaf and disabled telecommunication program was another one of those programs that was not collecting the money. And the reason why this is important is because in California, the way that it's set up for the telecommunication companies is that they report what they owe the CPUC. The CPUC, in their defense, or however you want to look at it, said that they didn't have enough staff to regulate and or oversee the telcos. So they set up an algorithm with a database and said, telcos, you can go into this database and tell us how much money you made this month, and then you'll go ahead and make that payment. And I don't know about you all, but I'd love to do that with my credit card companies. You know, hey, guys, I only owe this much. So that was a problem for me. And so one of the questions, you know, and the gentleman that went over the process with me at PUC really had, you know, they thought their program was great and it wasn't a bad program. But the question I asked them is, I said, do you audit the telcos and what they report to the CPUC? And the answer was, oh, we never thought of that. I'm like, yeah, that's not okay, guys. We got to do that. I will tell you, within 6 months of that conversation, I was terminated. It was not a popular conversation. It was not one that, and I was also in the process of regulating some of the telcos, really coming down on them, especially with the California fires, the fact that they didn't have their, we call them cows, their communication on wheels, there at fires because they were in some other part of the country, you know, because they can't afford to have more of those. And consequently, the first responders could not communicate with folks, and it was terrible. And because the cell towers were down, the phone lines were down. So I started to really dig in and start really looking at the regulations. And what I found is that we have rules that can regulate the telcos. However, we don't utilize them in California, and overall in the United States, the telecommunication companies are not regulated. In Europe, they are. In the United States, they are not. So you're paying more for your phone service than you should. And that's just a known thing throughout the United States.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, Alice. You are amazing. You've been through the fire, and I'm so happy that you are continuing the fight and bringing this awareness the way that you are, because we just don't know. You know, many of us, you know, just have no idea. And I really appreciate you sharing that. Thank you very much. Odette, if you would.
Yes, Alice. Wow. That's a tough act to follow, but I'm going to try. First of all, I've been a technology transactional attorney for over 20 years, and I've represented some very large multinational corporations. So I know a little bit about how technology companies work. I also formed a nonprofit called Wired Broadband, Inc. It's located in New York City, and we are primarily involved with opposing the 5G towers in New York City and 5G deployment in New York City. And there are a number of other organizations and individuals in New York City who have also joined in that effort. And we have now formed the New York City Alliance for Safe Technology, chair, co-founder, and general counsel of the National Call for Safe Technology. And that includes over 100 organizations, community groups, and individuals advocating for safe technology, for wired connectivity. And there's a lot more that I'm going to add in my presentation. So that should suffice for my introduction. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much, Odette. Odette calls it a national call for safe technology. I call it an international, worldwide call for safe technology. She has people from Australia, from the UK, and all over Europe that are sharing their stories about how the exact same thing that's happening here in the United States is happening everywhere. It's a very coordinated, concentrated, you know, specific strategy that is being imposed upon all consumers across the globe. And it's not unique just to the United States, though United States, in my opinion, is one of the more egregious violators, to steal the title from David's book. Odette's presentation is going to be fantastic, and looking forward to that. Let's go to Heather now.
My name is Heather Hutto. I serve as the executive director for the Bristow Public Library, which resides in Muscogee Creek Nation in Oklahoma. I'm about 30 minutes southwest of Tulsa. In the early aughts, I spent some time in San Francisco. It was really right around the time that the iPod and the iPad, just before the iPhone, were all rolled out. And seeing the adoption of those technologies really opened my mind to aspects of the digital divide that nobody else really seemed to be talking about. I returned back to my home state of Oklahoma and went ahead and pursued college education and graduate education. I have spent over 10 years in rural public libraries and rural public schools. Most of them are considered tribal rural. Most of the school districts I have served in are 50% or more Native American. And being able to see the stark differences in where people are at, not just as far as access to technology, but with their digital skills and information literacy, there were just overwhelming gaps compared to my experiences and the things that I observed out in the Bay Area of California. So I put all of that, put all of those observations to the task. And a few years ago, I co-authored a peer-reviewed paper called Tribal Rural Digital Inclusivity. And that paper did a content analysis approach comparison between two states, one with significant tribal populations and one without. And essentially, what my research has been able to determine thus far is that states with tribal populations are less likely to have been good stewards and good managers of information as it pertains to the digital divide and all of the intersecting issues therein. States without tribal populations do better in this regard. Since writing that peer-reviewed paper, I too have made some enemies, Alice. I ask those tough questions. And in my home state of Oklahoma, when I ask those really difficult questions, I'm usually encounter a phenomenon called toxic positivity. So that will suffice for an introduction, and I'll get more into that toxic positivity later on.
Fantastic. Yes. Thank you, Heather. You know, as I had, Heather and I, we spoke before we did a tech talk together. And when I shared her video, one of my colleagues of 35 years in California, who was working with Utility Reform Network, she's now retired, but she recommended Heather to be nominated to the FCC. She says, we need to recommend Heather to the FCC based on her commentary and her knowledge, just the you know, everything that she knows and how she presents. She's just a wonderful spirit. And I'm really happy to have you here, Heather. Thank you very much. David Rosen.
I've known for Bruce about 40 years. And we worked together in a consulting firm in New York. And I was the sort of the media guy, because I had worked at the Sundance Institute. I had got an Emmy for a TV series at the New York City Public Television Station. And then I got hooked up and became a technology guy, and I worked at Philips and then Commodore launching. I never launched a thing in my life. I became a marketing director. And then eventually started working with a lot of small, got out of that gig and spent a lot of time working on new media technology startups. And that was fun for a couple of years, and it was crazy. So in the meantime, though, I remained friends with Bruce and took his war against the telecom companies very seriously. And not only did I write two books with Bruce, we were hired by, what is this one, which you're welcome to, it's called Disconnect, and you're welcome to get it online. It's a PDF that you can download called Your Regulators. It was written in 2022, so it's a bit dated. And just as an aside, one of the chapters on digital inequality begins at a Native American community in Cuban, New Mexico, and the problems of receiving telecom services in New Mexico. The other book that we wrote or hired with Bruce is this one, which is really the whole 250 pages is his real work that he's done over the years to promote a critical analysis of the phone companies. So my comments really are, and then I've subsequently written any number of articles on the phone companies and what's going on with them. And this, so I come to this, as I said earlier in my introduction, with a very critical question, which is no one really cares. I mean, the joke that I've shared with Bruce, a friend of mine said it, and this guy's a PhD mathematician and was a professor in the university. He says, so what? You know, I pay my bill every month. one service is as bad as the next. They're all overcharged. They're all the same. So what? What do I do? I need my phone. And that's the question I tried very much to try to address and disconnect. Because what we looked at, what I was trying to look at, is further a set of context for people to understand how the system ended up where it is now, which is basically we're back to old monopolies of the Robert Barrett age of a century ago. And the fact that there is no essentially supervision or oversight by either state or federal government, and then second, what the role of all this, all the they're paying enormous amounts of money, not in political contributions, in all kinds of organizations that they fund to promote their agenda, and et cetera. And you can detail a lot of this in here, is we're fighting an uphill battle. And as I said earlier, and I really mean this, I'm not an expert on this subject, but I'm trying to be a good writer. I have a new book coming out next fall. You're welcome to look at it. But anyway, in the meantime, I'm looking for a scandal. And my so far, the most exciting thing that I've heard is Alice's experiences with the state PUC, because it's a clear case of a scandal that's waiting to be exposed, because it illustrates really just how, in fact, people systematically do not want to hear, and that those who are accountable don't want to know of what's going on and how people are getting ripped off. So please, friends, and anybody who's just participating in this conference call, come up with a great scandal. I'd really appreciate it. Thank you.
Hi, David, thank you. Thank you very much. David, you mentioned a great thing, and it's something that is personal experience with me, is that the NPOs, the NGOs, the nonprofit organizations are absolutely bought off in this situation. And they systematically, they being the incumbent players, that they will fund these nonprofit organizations, kind of a covert expectation that they know if you're funded by either AT&T or Verizon or one of the big incumbents, Comcast, there is an expectation that you will, when called to the day to testify before the regulatory agency, that you will show up and you will say lockstep, a scripted set of words that they give you, with the kind of the grassroots organizations being bought off. Then that enables the politicians, the elected officials, to be bought off, because now you have no opposition, and there are political representatives who I spoke to up and down California many times, our leadership, chairs of the education committee, majority leaders of the assembly. And these are friends for many years, decades that I've known, and they all come back with the same line. Oh, that happened so long ago. And, you know, what are you expecting me to do? And just very matter of factly, like there's nothing that we can do. And that's just not right. As we all know, that is not the strategy is at our disposal. With that, we're going to circle back to Alice. Let's continue this wonderful discussion. I thank you all for that absolute amazing, stellar introduction of where you guys are coming from. And so let's get started. So Alice, we'll turn it back to you now.
I'm going to go over a few things that I think are important for any of you who live in California, and this could relate to your own state's politics. And this comes from the California Public Utilities Commission perspective, which, by the way, is probably the most powerful and the most hated agency in California. Most powerful because it regulates not only telecommunications, but all the investor-owned utilities. So the PG&Es of the world, also SoCal Gas, the natural gas companies, the rail, every inch of rail in California, water, investor-owned utilities. So it has a huge responsibility. As it relates to the telecommunication companies and really everything that we regulate, one of the things that I found early on in my career there, and this is the part I think that is important to all of you, is that, you know, politicians are politicians, and they come to their constituents and they say, you know, we're not going to raise taxes. We're not going to create this or that. We're not going to do that. But what they do is they come to agencies like the Public Utilities Commission, and they say, you know what, we need you to create a program. And so the PUC will create a program, and that program is created with rate payer fees. So the politician didn't raise the taxes, but they backdoored you and created a program that the PUC can do because they have the authority to do that. Their five-member commission. That's kind of important, because if you, as the public, don't pay attention to what happens at the Public Utilities Commission, and most people don't, because we all have lives, and who wants to, you know, you're supposed to trust your government, right? You're supposed to trust those folks that make the rules. Unfortunately, you know, they're listening to, in some cases, their bosses, the politicians, and they're doing what they're supposed to do, or that what they think they're supposed to do. You know, I was a cog in the wheel at the PUC, as I noted before, and I didn't agree with a lot of these decisions. A lot of these programs were created way before I started, and those were the same programs that I was coming in and looking at and wanting to audit and investigate and make sure the money was being spent appropriately, that the individuals who were supposed to receive the equipment were receiving it, that the vendors who were giving them the equipment were actually real, you know, they were good people. They weren't swindlers. I saw everything at the PUC. I will tell you, I worked for the state for 34 years, and I have never, ever seen the things I saw at the PUC in any other state agency. And I worked for the Department of Justice. I worked for the Department of Transportation. I worked for the Water Board and the Air Resources Board. And CARB has its own political issues when it comes to air quality standards and things like that, but nothing like the PUC. So I just, again, that's background for a lot of these programs and what happens. And unfortunately, you know, I think we're in a situation in California where leave your brain at the door and just do what you're told and you'll be okay. I kind of see that in other states, and I see that a bit across the country as well. I will just say, don't fall for that. Don't do that. You need to have integrity, and you need to continue. And I assume that everybody's on this call because of that, and that you all have integrity and you all want changes and you all want to do the right thing. The other thing that is interesting too, is that a lot of my commissioners that I worked for, not all of them, but many of them went and worked for those individuals that we regulated. They went and worked for the telecommunication companies or the investor-owned utilities. And that tells me that, you know, I mean, that says a lot right there. And they're not going to make enemies because they want a job and they're going to make a lot of money. And they're probably going to make 4 to 5 times more money than anybody. I mean, when I was at the PUC, I was the executive director, and I made as much as an engineer at the Pacific Gas and Electric. Everyone almost at the PG&E made more than I did at the PUC. So you can see that people are interested. But at the same time, I didn't sign up to be rich when I became a government employee. I signed up to, you know, I had very high aspirations and lots of things that I thought this, you know, the government should be. And I was unfortunately very, very, very disappointed. Not to say I didn't meet some wonderful people there and do some good work, but I also found that a lot of the work that we did, if you leave an agency, it was destroyed later. It was not upheld. So again, I'll go back to, for you all, and as you, you know, look at your cell phone every day and you're looking at, what am I paying for? You look on the back of your bill and see how many programs are on the back of your bill that you didn't know about. How many programs are there? And what are those fees that they're charging? And what are those fees going to? You can write letters to your politicians. You can write letters to the PUC. I'm not going to tell you it's going to make a difference. It might make you feel better. But that's one of the reasons why we're here. And we're trying to come up with ways that we can make things better when it comes to regulating the telecommunication companies, because right now they are not regulated. They are not being held accountable. And I can give you one example where I sent a group of staff. One of the things that we were trying to do at the PUC was manage telephone poles. I know that sounds funny, but you know, telephone poles. Well, there's thousands, millions of telephone poles. Who owns them? Well, kind of an interesting story about telephone poles and 5G and all those things. Well, if you know anything about 5G, you know that they're like giant suitcases on top of a telephone pole. That's what it looks like, 5G. And you have to be within a certain parameter to be able to get 5G. It almost has to be visible from your house for you to get it. And so we were trying to determine who owned the telephone poles, what was going on. Well, at the same time, you know, brilliant, the telcos went to DC and they wanted to put a limit on what somebody could charge them to lease space on the pole. And that's an important thing, because if you're looking at 5G and if 5G needs to be visible, you know that it's going to have to be on every telephone pole. Now, technology can change. That can all be different. And maybe we don't need to do that in 5 years or 10 years. But for now, that's what we need to do. And so consequently, you've got a situation where the telcos are in DC getting that law change, which they did. Now, if you're a small vendor and you want to get access to that pole, that telephone pole, you have to pay for it. And you're going to pay the telecommunication company or whoever owns that pole. And most of the telcos own the poles. PG&E doesn't own the pole, even though they're the investor-owned electric utility who, you know, has so much responsibility. But yet at the same time, you never hear about the responsibility of the telecommunication companies when a pole goes down, when it falls on a car, when anything happens. It's just so backwards. And going back to my original story, when we went to one of these telecommunication companies, national telecommunication companies, to get information about their poles, they put my staff in a room and said, "We're going to tell you all about it." And they just turned on videos. And then they said, "You know what? Sorry, we really don't have time for you today." And they left. That's how they treat the regulators in California. And that's real. And when I came back and reported that, and I was getting all my attorneys together at the PUC going, "Okay, this is not acceptable. We need to do something." I was shut down. I was told, "Be quiet, go away, do something else. But you're not going to even touch any of that." So I've thrown a lot of information at you. I'm trying to do as quickly as possible too. There's lots and lots of information to share. If you have questions, I'm happy to answer those later. I know Larry's going to facilitate that process. But again, just pay attention. Talk to your friends. You know, maybe all of us can make a difference. Maybe David can get that super awesome story going and we can make it a bigger deal and we can make some change, because things have to change. Telecommunications is way too expensive. And I don't know how many of you watch sports, but if you look at all the commercials, it's all telecommunications, and that's coming from all of us. So with that, Larry, I will pass the baton.
Getting shut down, like you are the regulatory agency.
Oh, I mean, they flipped us the bird. Just sort of like, yeah, we don't care.
Yeah, that is just like, how do they get away with that? If you would, just for point of clarification, this is not just a one-time thing. This is happening to you guys as a regulatory body all the time, right? It's really the proverbial tail wagging the dog in a very literal sense, right?
Yeah, I would say in all the other areas that we regulated at the PUC, I felt that if I wrote them a letter or said something to them, they adhered to it. The telcos, no. They did not.
Wow. We want to get more into that as it relates to, you know, how is that even possible, that this does not seem right.
And the only thing I'll add to that, Larry, because I know I have a little bit more time, is that during the California fires, because I was unfortunately at the PUC when the Paradise fire hit, and you know, PG&E was responsible for that fire. That was terrible. I mean, that was catastrophic. It, you know, every bad thing imaginable. And I remember having to drag all of the, not only the utilities, but the telcos into rooms and literally meet with them weekly as we were going through fire season to tell them what their responsibility was and what they needed to do. Because, you know, like most big companies, they want to, you know, duck and bob and weave and duck and not take responsibility. And we held them to the fire. We really, really, I mean, but it was hard. It was really, really hard. And there was no pun intended there.
Well, thank you very much. We're going to turn to our next panelist now, Odette Wilkins. Go ahead.
All right. Well, I'm going to give you a little bit of a microcosm in terms of what we're doing in New York City. And then I'm going to bring it out into the bigger picture. So first of all, I just want to show you what these 5G towers look like. We have about 2,000 coming our way. And they are three stories high, and they can, there's no setback requirement. And you see how close these can be to a building? And the middle one was taken by New Yorkers for WireTech. And that is, that shows you the scale of this tower to how small the people are. And the one on the right shows an ad. They have towers with ads and without ads. And the pictures on the left and the right were taken from a presentation by the Office of Technology and Innovation. Now, in the far distance, in the picture on your left, there is a pole top antenna as well. So just wanted to bring that to your attention. Now, what's comprised of what is contained in these towers is five levels of antennas. The top two are 5G, the next two are 4G, and then the last one is Wi-Fi. So these people are going to be blasted with radiation right outside of their bedrooms. But we've been, we've had quite a bit of opposition in New York City. And right now, 16 New York City community boards have issued moratoria or disapprovals. That represents about 2 million New York City residents, or 25% of New York City. That's a very large number, and the mayor didn't see that coming. But of course, there are health issues, public safety, nuisance, privacy, reduced property values, and its ugly and obtrusive design. And those were issues that were brought up in those moratoria and disapprovals. And then we also have these backpacks that are placed on existing utility poles. So it's not enough to have these. We're going to have about, I don't know, anywhere from 11,000 to 14,000 of them on city poles in New York City. So why are we going to, why do we need the Link 5G cell towers? And this is a close-up view of a pole-top antenna right outside a child's bedroom. This is what it looks like in New York City when we have a whole bunch of rooftop antennas that have been installed on top of a roof. So I really feel badly for the people living right underneath them, because I've known people who have lived underneath rooftop antennas and they got very sick. Now, what's very interesting about these 5G towers is that there's already graffiti. And you see there's a stick-on sign that's been placed askew on the pole, and there's also graffiti on this side. There's also the other side that has graffiti as well. And this is in my neighborhood. I live in Forest Hills. That's actually Rego Park. Now, the reason for these, this wireless radiation and this plethora of cell towers is for the purpose, purportedly, to bridge the digital divide. Except that, for instance, in New York City, that's really not the case. because it's providing free Wi-Fi. The 5G towers are providing free Wi-Fi, but that's designed for street use. That's not designed for home use. So when you think of bridging the digital divide, don't you think, first of all, of home use, not street use? And of course, the subscription services for 4G and 5G are for a fee. And the fees are not regulated, so they can charge whatever they want. So who can afford the new 5G, 6G, 7G phones and services? The economic model of technology companies, and I know this because I've worked with vendors, is that there is a planned obsolescence in order to generate future revenue. And what they do is they artificially retire a product or a service in order to compel consumers to buy the new products and services. That's the economic model, plain and simple. Now, another thing about bridging the digital divide, you'd think that has to do with finding out where there's a gap in service. Well, do you know that there were community boards that had asked, where is the gap in service? How did you determine that this is where the 5G tower is supposed to be, as opposed to someplace else? And you know what the answer was? The telecoms view that as proprietary information. Okay, so first of all, they're using the public rights of way. There is no proprietary information. If they're using the public rights of way, they have to disclose the information. That would be my rule, number one. And secondly, they have to show a gap in service. Otherwise, what's the point of saying bridging the digital divide? Then you're not bridging anything. Because if you can't show that there's a gap in service, and that's the one that you're filling when you're putting a cell tower someplace, then the argument of bridging the digital divide fails. And so that's just a canard, bridging the digital divide. Now, of course, if you really want to bridge the digital divide, fiber as a national priority. Now, there's also coaxial cable. There's also landlines, copper wires. But for the moment, let's just talk about fiber. Now, the NTIA affirms fiber to the premises as a national priority. And the former SEC chair, Tom Wheeler, stated that fiber is future-proof and using wireless only as a last resort. And that was according to his testimony in Congress of March of 2020. And of course, this has in-home use benefits. It's unmatched in speed, reliability, capacity, cybersecurity, and has a very long lifespan of 25 to 50 years. Wireless, I've heard, only has about a 5-year lifespan and needs constant maintenance. But you know what's happening? What's happening is that the telecoms are getting everyone focused on bridging the digital divide. But that is taking away people's attention from their landlines. So they're saying bridge the digital divide for broadband, but then without letting us know too much, they want to take away our landlines. That's exactly what has been happening with the CPUC, the California Public Utilities Commission. And they've been entertaining a petition by AT&T to retire their landlines so that they wouldn't have to maintain them. But what has happened is that in California, the CPUC saw firsthand the limitations of wireless in emergencies. First of all, cell phones may not work in an emergency, and there's no way to call 911 unless you have a landline. And then there might be a fire to the cell tower. There have been a number of cell tower fires, especially in California. If the cell tower is on fire, guess what? You can't make a cell phone call. Now, what if they're operating normally? The lines get congested during emergencies. So everybody's trying to call. And that's what happened in 2011 in the East Coast during an earthquake. Many people could not make a call with their cell phones because there was so much congestion, even though the equipment was working. But the landlines worked fine. And then, of course, there's the unexplained times when the system goes down. And in California in 2024, this year, over 70,000 people were left stranded without being able to call 911 in the Bay Area. Okay? So the CPUC has proposed rejecting the petition. So I don't know if they've already ruled on it or if they've rejected it or what, but let's hope that they make the right decision. So as you can see, there's no paucity of limitations of wireless technology, but none of these apply to wireless. Fiber in New York City is very interesting. We have been told that fiber is going to be laid by the site developer, CityBridge, who is putting up these 2,000 5G towers. But it's not all free, because in the contract between CityBridge and the city, it states that if CityBridge uses a third-party fiber provider and the franchise agreement between the city and CityBridge expires and is not renewed, then the third-party fiber providers may charge New York City market rates at the expiration of the CityBridge franchise agreement. Market rates. New York City, and meanwhile, CityBridge is saying, oh, this is all free, but they're not telling people and not telling the public about this this information that's in the contract. That means that New York City would have to make perpetual payments to those third-party fiber providers in order to maintain fixed wireless broadband. Now, the problem is that fiber architecture for fixed wireless facilities is not necessarily compatible with fiber architecture to the premises. So this may be giving us ice in winter. Chattanooga, Tennessee is a model for municipal fiber. New York City is a model for what you don't want to do. But Chattanooga, Tennessee is a model for what you do want to do, and that is leasing fiber to the telecoms because they own the fiber. So now they have a perpetual stream of revenue coming into the system, coming into the city. Beautiful. That's what sustainability looks like. That's what resiliency looks like. And you know what they are able to do? They don't need the affordable connectivity program, because they're providing each household with a school-aged child free internet. And meanwhile, Chattanooga, Tennessee is an all-fiber network, and they have the fastest internet in the United States and one of the fastest in the world. And they're going quantum too. And that's because they have a fiber network. You can't do that with wireless, not even with 5G. Okay, so now we come to the bigger picture. There is no regulation for safety in the United States for wireless, for wireless emissions. No one is regulating the safety of wireless emissions, or we also call it electromagnetic frequency or electromagnetic fields. Not the EPA, not the FDA, not the FCC, not the CDC since about the mid 1990s, as I've been told. The FCC's website even states that they don't have enough personnel to monitor compliance. Now, the EPA was defunded back in the 1990s. There was a large study done, and the EPA was involved in the research studying the safety of this radiation in the 1990s. After the research concluded that the radiation was dangerous or posed a high risk of harm and was producing biological effects with the potential for health hazards, the EPA was defunded, and they lost jurisdiction on this particular area. So they were defunded in this area. The EPA must reclaim its jurisdiction. Prior to the Telecommunications Act of 1996, you had cabinet level regulatory agencies like the EPA, FDA, and others, and OSHA, who are responsible for the safety of those exposed to radio frequency radiation. The EPA was responsible for emissions from wireless infrastructure, including cell towers. But after the Telecommunications Act, the EPA was relegated to an advisory role. That's a problem, because the FCC is not a health agency, and yet they're the ones who have been relegated with the responsibility for public safety. They basically deal with interference from devices. And so that is their primary focus, not interference in terms of health. So
that's wild. Yeah. Thank you, Odette. I mean, can we hold that next piece?
Okay, sure.
For the second round, but that is such a parallel to Alice's experience, where they were telling her to walk away, you know, don't investigate anymore. And so the EPA finds out that wireless is harmful. And then they say, okay, well, now we're going to take all your money away so you can't do any more research in that area. It's a well thought out, you know, hundreds of corporate lawyers thinking about how do we, you know, shut this stuff down kind of strategy. And that's, I think that's what we're kind of missing. We're not getting that they got hundreds of lawyers thinking about this every day, every minute. You know, this stuff is not just happenstance occurring. It is things that is actually part of a larger strategy that is being weaponized against us. And it has been for decades now. When was the EPA defunded? What was the year again?
In the mid-1990s.
In the mid-1990s.
Finally it was defunded probably around 1999.
Well, thank you, Odette. More to come on that and on the second round here. David, we're going to turn to you now, sir.
Well, unfortunately, I don't think I have as much depth of field. That was a very informative piece. Thank you very much. Both the preceding two speakers, I appreciate it. But I'd like to focus perhaps on something which, again, I'm not an expert in this, is how, in fact, the telecom industry was able to finagle the move from its initial, under the original Telecommunications Act of 34, from a Title I, which is information services, to a Title II, which is non-commercial, consumer services. I'm going blank on it. How the fact that we've moved more and more to an information service, i.e. unregulated telecom economy, and that the fact that what is essentially was initially the telephone was considered a common carrier and was actually regulated. And what we're witnessing, again, and I think what your description of what happened with the APA in terms of defunding it, is part and parcel of this process by which we shifted away from a Title II to a Title I economy. And again, I would argue that, in fact, this is what American economy has turned into. Everything is buyer, seller, and maximize return on investment economy and not the public good. So I don't know if I need to find the position to discuss all this with any kind of authority, because again, as I've tried to stress, I'm not an expert in this field, but I would really like to hear other people's opinion about this issue of Title I and Title II, and if we can actually, if in fact we could ever get back to a Title II telecom world, if that's feasible, or if that's like, you know, something of the past.
Can you articulate what does Title II represent for the consumer? How does that empower them?
What I understand to be the case, and please, you people who know far more, please, is common carrier. That is, in a public interest, that the telephone serve the community of needs. And this is 1934. This is analog. This is AT&T was the dominant provider. And so they had to meet the needs of their customer base. I mean, they made a lot of money, please, and they acquired a lot of assets along the way. But they still had a responsibility because these were not considered information services. And I apologize, I wrote it in this book that I referred to, but I just can't pull it out of my head right now. When in fact, there was the shift when the first information services were expanded. I know it's been done for the internet. Cable television was also considered an information service, that is conventional old-fashioned cable. But I don't remember exactly and I think I do document this in the book, but I just can't remember it, is how in fact the shift occurred between Title II to Title I, and that more less and less of what you're accessing in terms of your telephone service, particularly what goes on wirelessly, that's a Title I function. So that's basically not covered by the Telecommunications Act. If that's my understanding of it, that's what I think I wrote. I don't know if other people have thought about this issue, because I think it's critical, because it essentially gives us, if you will, or at least a kind of a ground to stand on to say that this was actually what is meant by the different domains of telecom service, and we should return to a tele a world in which Title II, that is common carrier, is essentially the ground rules that everybody gets. And this overcomes the digital divide, if you ask me. So I don't know if other people have thought about this or what their opinion is. That I'd very much appreciate
it. The fiber was laid under Title II, which meant that these were federal dollars, that it belongs to the state utility. And if it belongs to the state utility, it consequently belongs to the state, which is us, right? The taxpayers, the ratepayers. And so with that, it means that, you know, the promises that were made relative to, as these fees and taxes were being assessed, that everybody would be connected to fiber, the dream of having fiber optics everywhere, that regardless of location, region, income level, that was going to be the infrastructure, that fiber optics was going to be the infrastructure. The manipulation of the Title I to Title II took place, or Title II to Title I, the incumbent players took that resource that belonged to the public and then essentially privatized it and said, this is ours, and we don't need to, you know, do, you know, what we said we were going to do. And basically there's nothing you can do about it because this is ours. And you talk to the municipalities and most everybody say, oh, well, that's their wires. You know, everybody, even the unions, even CWA, Communication Workers of America, their understanding is that the wagon that they're pulling, I'll say it like that, is that no, those wires belong to AT&T and not to the public. I'm going to stop right there, David, and I want to bring home this first round with Heather. Heather, if you would. Heather, thank you.
Okay, so this is going to seem out of left field, but I want everyone to take just a moment and think about the text or the movie, whichever speaks to you, of The Wizard of Oz. Because growing up as a kid, it always seemed odd to me that the people who lived in the Emerald City never caught on to the fact that the wizard was a phony, right? He was pulling one over on them, essentially. And it took Dorothy and her new friends and that little dog Toto pulling the curtain to unearth the truth, right? And cause some change. So just put that aside. Historically, tribal communities in my state have been left out of vital broadband conversations. In fact, tribal communities within my state have been the last to get all forms of utilities. Namely, remote rural parts of Cherokee Nation were just getting running water in the mid-1980s. So when I was a toddler in diapers, there were people who lived near me who did not have running water. Things are better. But not to be toxically positive about it, things are better for some, but we still need to focus on where things are lacking. And I do believe that's why we are all here today. Seeing that disconnect, seeing that digital divide and how it played out in rural tribal communities was the impetus for me to co-author that peer-reviewed research. And I can share more about that later. But what I would like to really touch base on is the content analysis approach that I took in that paper, because I think it would be applicable for many different communities, many different states. It may even be a beneficial approach to kind of thinking about how these things play out at the federal level as well. So knowledge management, just a Googled definition of knowledge management, is that it is a multidisciplinary approach to help organizations achieve their goals by making the best use of knowledge and information. It involves creating, sharing, storing, and using knowledge. I have a whole textbook here on knowledge management as a subject. It's definitely a growing field, and it's very relevant to all of us as we find ourselves in the information era. So in the content analysis approach that myself and my co-author took, we use the lens of knowledge management, or the tone, the aperture of our research. We basically compared governmental agencies and how well they did or did not get the word out about broadband initiatives and other measures to close the digital divide. We also looked at local media coverage to see what local media were or were not doing. We also focused in on some state agencies that were relevant to our field, namely states' departments of libraries and states' departments of education. Unfortunately, a lot of agencies and a lot of institutions and organizations just really didn't meet the mark. In fact, if I had to give them a grade, it would be a D, just barely above failing. In some states, governments are really bad in getting the word out. In Oklahoma, where I'm from, well into the pandemic, the state still did not actually have an office of broadband. It did not have a broadband office. In fact, the state in which I live had to scramble and kind of fly by the seat of their pants just to create a broadband office so that that way they could actually receive the ARPA funds for broadband build out. Notwithstanding, governmental agencies were really bad during the pandemic at getting the word out at any measures, whether that was ECF or ACF or any available initiatives that were around. Local media, not too far from state agencies. There were a few news affiliates that did have little posts about, hey, you can apply for ACF or ECF if you're having a hard time getting your work done at home or attending school on home. But other than a few blips on nightly news stations, there really wasn't any coverage. No local news affiliates, no local radio stations, no newspapers, social media, just it didn't exist whatsoever. And unfortunately, the people who did get the message weren't the people who needed to get the message the most. The people who did actually find out about initiatives, such as incoming ARPA funding, ECF, ACF, those people happened to be urban-dwelling individuals who already were connected and were already watching their televisions and computer screens and got the message. The people who needed to get the message were the people who lived out in rural communities who at best have highly overpriced satellite internet or nothing at all. And so it was just across the board, just a communication fail. And then surprisingly, states' departments of libraries and states' departments of education also really had mixed results. Some of these state agencies were not really prepared for the pandemic, and it showed. One state in particular, Department of Libraries and Professional Organization for Libraries, did not even have a single topic of professional development that approached the topic of the digital divide. I searched through years and years of conference materials and other publications, and that state's Professional Library Association had never even touched the topic of the digital divide. So we have some gaps here, and all of these things intersect. And all of these things contribute to the digital divide. And how that plays out is probably much more wider in scope than any of us realize. Much more research needs to be done. And that research may be the impetus to wrangling this problem. I would assert, I would argue that everything from low civic awareness to low democratic participation, low workforce readiness, low education attainment, the divisiveness that we all see in our communities and in our society at large, all of these things are connected to the digital divide. And if you'll humor me, I have one more comparison that I would like to make. My board here at the library, I needed a work phone. And so they authorized me to use some of the library's funds to go and get a phone. However, they only authorized me to get a prepaid phone from my local Walmart. Okay, that's all right. So I go, I pay for my prepaid phone, I pay for my card, and I have the experience that so many low-income rural individuals have. I had a lot of challenges in getting the prepaid phone turned on, programmed, updated, and then adding my minutes. The entire process actually took more than a day. So the second day, I try it again. And actually, the operating system had bricked, because all of the accounts that I have associated with me, both professionally and personally, were getting too many notifications, and the internet signal was in and out. And so when the notifications would come in, they would actually brick the phone. And so that was really telling for me, because it put me instantly in the perspective of so many of my rural patrons and what they experience. So many of them do not, 50% actually, do not have internet where they live. They either have to drive down the road, go to a gas station, walk up a hill. They have to go somewhere in order to access the internet. And often when they do access the internet, it's on a cell phone. It's more economical for them to open up a social media app, such as Twitter, now known as X, or Facebook, than it is to actually get on a web browser, read the news, fact check the news, look at multiple information resources, and practice strong digital citizenship and strong information literacy. Simply put, it's not economic, so they ain't gonna do that. So, those of us who are urban dwelling, we have technology access and informational literacy skills. We're looking at the world through a lens that's like this. It's pretty wide. The aperture is set wide enough that we can see through it. It's clear. It's transparent. We have a much better chance of seeing what's real and what may not be. People who live in rural areas, their access is so scant, and their decisions are economic by nature. Remember, most people who live in rural areas use really expensive satellite internet. It's so cost prohibitive to so many people that they rely on their phones, and they don't have constant access. And so their interpretation of the world and the information within it is much more constricted or narrow. How can a society function when it's not well informed? Our founding father said that it can't, actually. So from where I'm sitting, and I'm a librarian, so I'm a little bit biased in this, but access is imperative to democracy. And if there are any politicians out there that happen to hear this message, please hear this. It is a waste of time, of your time, of my time, of our time, for you to not pick up this problem and start tackling it. Somebody needs to start. It's also a waste of taxpayer funds to keep this dysfunctional problem rolling. So now I'm going to pivot back to the Wizard of Oz, right? It takes us pulling back that curtain and exposing the wizard for whom he is, he being the collective conglomerate of monopolies and other stakeholders that have contributed to this problem. And perhaps there are some who have used manipulation and abused power and have abused resources, but there's just as many, if not more, who have just been complacent. At this point, it doesn't really matter. We just have to fix the problem.
That was spectacular, Heather. Thank you so much for that. I absolutely, you know, the parallels that you draw with the complacency and the access to democracy. So the infrastructure from economic, you know, prosperity for new ideas and new concepts to, as you stated so clearly and articulately, to just basic democracy, you know, and having people to become aware of, you know, the things that Alice has shared and the things that Odette has shared, not knowing it. I love the idea, the prop that you use. You know, if you have access, you got a clear kind of look at it. But if you don't know about it, and it really kind of sets it up, again, you have to believe that the incumbent players are purposefully have strategized with this in mind, knowing that most people are not going to engage because they simply just can't. They physically do not have the infrastructure that are going to be able to allow them to continue. Thank you so much for using that analogy. You said it well when you said they're wasting our time. Our political leadership is wasting our time. And I think it may be like if our elected officials are not going to take this issue up, then we need to get them out of there. they need to be out of there, and because it affects exactly, you know, all of the things that we've all shared here, like right now, you know. And those are the buzzwords right now. I love that you already incorporated that, right? You know, democracy is at risk. Well, democracy has never been more at risk than if we don't have the right information, right, that's in front of us. I want to open it up to the panel. Are there questions that we'll take the next 10 to 12 minutes to ask any questions? David, you had a question?
I would like to just add, again, this is a little bit dated, to remind people that for all the suffering that's going on, and I'm not trying to minimize it, in rural America and within the native populations of this country, in my book, I talk about that about 800,000 New Yorkers don't have access to the internet, 1.5 million students. So school-age kids don't have any kind of access. 800,000 households don't have it. And then in Southern California, this is a couple of years ago, something in the order of like 18% of the households don't have it. So we're dealing with a problem that's fundamental to, and it's, but I, in this book of art, myself and Bruce, I call it digital inequality, because it's more than a divide. It's a way in which the whole system, like the economic system, is structured on incredible, ever-increasing inequality as you move down the line. The super rich and the super well-to-do with, you know, all the way down to the bottom of the barrel, which is unfortunately in New York, I know, because it's not far from my house. So I just want to keep this perspective open to really the level of suffering that's going on throughout the country because of this. That's my two cents.
Great, thank you.
I was just gonna interject a little bit. I'm always gonna go back to money because that's kind of what I do. And one of the things I did recognize in California, and again, something else I was trying to change, I know, Odette, you talked about landlines. So landlines in California are virtually disappearing. But what's interesting about the rules around the funding for landlines is that the landlines were funding everything.
Right.
And the wireless was funding very little. And that was something that California had not changed the rules on the funding. So, and that's, for me, that's a huge audit issue, because the color of money has to, you know, if you're paying for something and you're being regulated for something, that money has to go to where it's supposed to go. And it needs to remain in that area. In California, I can assure you that's not happening. And that is a big, big problem. And I think that that's, you know, again, you got to go to the baseline of where that money is going and where it's not going. And I think that's a huge, huge issue, probably in all the states. I think it's larger than anybody realizes.
Yeah, I'd like to add to that, because one of the things that I put together in a response to the BEAD funding was that there need to be conditions precedent to any qualification for BEAD funding. Mm-hmm. And one of the conditions precedent is precisely what Alice was talking about, that if they accepted any applicant who accepted public funding on the state or federal level and did not produce the results that they were intended to do with that money, then they are disqualified automatically. And if they find that they cannot identify the results, and they did not achieve the results after they received funding, that would be referred to the state AG for further investigation.
Yeah.
That is what we need. We need preconditions for the BEAD funding, preconditions for applicants for BEAD funding, in order to make them accountable mm-hmm. for the funding they already received. And it doesn't matter if they didn't receive it on the federal level, on any level. That's my rule number two. Odette's rule number two.
I love it. Yeah.
Agree.
Heather, did you want to share?
You know, I thought it was really interesting that Odette talked about planned obsolescence, especially, and not, I'm so sorry to keep steering this back towards rural and tribal communities. It's not. And I do definitely acknowledge that we don't even know exactly how many people are disconnected because nobody has actually done that research to really figure out how many people are actually disconnected. But in the state in which I live, where I serve as library director, 50% of my patrons do not have high-speed internet access. 70% have low digital literacy. And I see how that pans out for them every day. It's kind of like the first bad step down into an abyss of very bad things. So many of the people where I live, if they do have internet access, it is cost prohibitive satellite internet. And that satellite internet and the technology that holds it up hasn't changed very much in this region. Rates have gone up exponentially, but the quality of service has stayed the same. And the tragic irony where I live, where we have tornadoes that, you know, do billions of dollars in damage and take human life, we have fail-safe, or we don't have a fail-safe system. Where I live just 15 minutes from downtown Tulsa. And last year we had a 100 mile an hour derecho. And during that 100 mile an hour derecho, I could not get TV signal. I could not get internet. I had no way to communicate. Luckily, I had my old fashioned weather radio on battery. And that is how I knew to take cover and I knew what was going on. So it's silly to me that in 2024, we're still relying on these proprietary types of technology because fiber isn't made available. And it's almost as if it lends itself to the notion anyway, that telecoms, their whole planned obsolescence has more to do with, it's broader than just whether or not you have access to fiber or wireless, right? Here where I live, it's no. Let's make sure they only know about satellite internet and let's make them think that's all that's available. Let's not even start talking about fiber in all of these rural communities because the return on investment isn't worth it to us. And so just this idea of this planned obsolescence, I'm sure that at some point in my lifetime, fiber will finally be laid to these rural communities. But until that time, until their current satellite, overpriced satellite internet is decreed by the telecom company to be obsolete, then we're just going to keep perpetuating the cycle in rural America.
That's correct. Well, you know, you have a solution, and that's Utopia Fiber. They are they're in Utah, and they have there's a consortium of about 11 or 12 towns that got banded together to decide to go with fiber.
Right.
And Kim McKinley is the head of VP of marketing, and I had her on my one of my town halls. And it was fantastic. And they export their model to different states and they work with different states. So I can put you in touch with Kim McKinley of Utopia Fiber because this is exactly what they do.
That's the model. The whole Muni Fiber concept does so much across the board from an economic standpoint, the revenue that's generated from the municipality as a result of being a provider, that's a new revenue stream that did not previously exist, the construction part of it, and then short-term job creation, that's another part of it, the education in terms of the digital divide and duplicating what Odette was saying that Chattanooga is doing in terms of getting all of their low-income students that are free and reduced lunch can actually get free access, which is that, I mean, that's the vision. And this is something that, David, that Bruce wrote about maybe 12 years ago, where he was saying that it costs AT&T, according to their own data, according to AT&T's own data in New York, it was costing them $2.63 a month to make sure to send a signal so that somebody had internet access. Meanwhile, they're charging hundreds, you know, hundreds of dollars every month to the consumer. Though their only cost, and again, to their records, right, was $2.63. New York's data on AT&T, Chattanooga being able to do it for free. You have FAR Texas, PJRR, that's on the border of Mexico, down there at the in the Rio Grande, offering $25 per month, half a gig up and down to their households. The whole thing about the pricing and the deregulation, the lack of oversight on these issues, you know, to what to your point, Alice, is, you know, how do we get there? How do we, you know, and as we move into this next round, I want us to share more about, like, how do we get there? How do we, so we know that muni fiber, municipal fiber, that's the way to go. We know we have models that are already out there. We know that there's a lack of accountability. You know, our organization was, you know, and I dare say a favorite child of AT&T and Verizon when we were on board with their mission. You know, when we would testify before the city council in LA or before the CPUC, and we would say, yes, 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 what these guys want to do, we should do, not knowing any better and very naive and, you know, new to the process. And you're just happy as a nonprofit organization, you're elated that you're getting funding from a major corporation like Verizon or AT&T, and that you can get these guys on the phone and you're saying, like, oh my gosh, you know, I'm talking to AT&T or I'm talking to, you know, and then, you know, and you have their labels and you have their marketing materials all over your stuff. And knowing that in the back rooms with 100 lawyers, they're specifically working to, you know, to really do you in, you know, they have no intent of providing, you know, the access that they're saying, hey, we support you, Larry, and all your good work that you're doing and the thousands of families that you're helping, you know, across the digital divide, you know, we got you, you know. But in the back end, they're redlining, you know, our communities. They're not making good on the promises of connecting everybody. The whole thing about creating more jobs, lower prices, you know, better connectivity. That's the three that they have you go up and say whenever a merger is taking place. Like the last merger was with the cable company, Time Warner and Spectrum. And I specifically flew to Sacramento to protest that. And I said that was a bad idea, that, you know, that these things that they say is going to happen is not going to happen. They're not going to close the digital divide. They're not going to give access to these people. And sure enough, you know, here we are, you know, some 8 years later, we have very, you know, we have a monopolistic market. There's one provider, you know, two providers in Pomona, between Frontier and Spectrum, and prices, and they just coincidentally, you know, it's by chance, you guys, they charge the exact same high price, you know, for the exact same service, you know, just out of pure sure happenstance, right? No, I doubt it. But, you know, with the municipal broadband alternative, that would be able to create the competition necessary within our communities, create the jobs and everything. So many benefits that would be able to happen as a result of that, and getting people on board with the, Odette, you know, you had mentioned Ms. McKinley from Utopia. They're one model of, you know, a couple others that I can think about that are just doing fantastic work, but not enough people know about that, particularly in California. You know, the thing that opened the doors for my eyes is when I went to the Fiber Broadband Association conference in 2022, you know, the people were looking at California as kind of like, you know, like the blind, you know, that they really didn't know what was going on. And it was so true. I didn't know about these muni broadband models. You know, you listen to Communication Workers of America, and they would tell you, no, AT&T owns all those lines. And, you know, those things, you know, are not completely true and are challengeable. I think, Alice, I think you would agree a lot of the fiber, you know, was laid under Title II. And technically, it would appear, at least, you know, our understanding would be this, that those resources belong to the public. We'll go to Alice and then Odette and then David and then Heather. We'll have you close it up.
I'm going to be fairly quick. There's three things that stood out to me when we were chatting. Odette, I sent a, a quick little comment that 5G is attached to autonomous vehicles too. And that was another area that we were regulating at the PUC. Without 5G, you cannot have autonomous vehicles at all. And that's a big deal because that just puts the pressure on even more. And of course, there's dollars surrounded by that as well. The other thing was, I had mentioned it earlier, the cows, we call them cows, communication on wheels. When there's any type of catastrophe in any state, the telecommunications state, you know, throughout the U.S. are required to bring out cows for that community. So there's no loss in service. And I know they're supposed to do that, especially for the first responders so that they can communicate to each other. I know that was a huge problem in California during the fires. Our first responders couldn't, the firemen could not communicate with each other. And that's a huge, huge issue. We were told at the time that there were only so many cows that were available in California. And at the time of the California fires, they were back in, I think, Heather, like in the, they were back in Oklahoma or somewhere else. And so we couldn't get them out here. And I'm thinking, then get more. I mean, you guys have a ton of money. It's like, are you kidding me? So that's just, again, it's something to be aware of. And I remember I was driving around in Marin because we had some issues with a utility down in that area. And I noticed that I think the director of one of the telcos lived in the area that I was driving, and there were three cows within 6 miles. And it was a very well-to-do, rich area. And I have to say it made me a little sick to my stomach because it's like, guys, why aren't these out in the rural areas that have nothing? Again, something we were trying to regulate and we're getting shut down on. And then the other thing, David, I was thinking, and Heather, you reminded me of this. And David, maybe this is another issue to look into. Metro PCS had a big lawsuit here in California for prepaid phones. And I think the lawsuit was up in the numbers of like 280 million. It could have been more than that, but it was at least at a minimum 280 million. And it was because they were collecting the money and not remitting it back to the state. And this was money they collected from customers and they never remitted it. The last I heard, the state had negotiated with them to drop it down to like 90 million, which again, they collected the money. It's like you're collecting sales tax, but you're not paying it right. It's like, are you kidding me? You know, at the same time, these folks are coming after me for money from my lawsuit. So it just makes me laugh. It's like, really? So those were the kind of the things I just wanted to highlight that I heard when all the speakers were talking. And I did do a PRA, David, on the Metro PCS issue. If you want to look at any of those documents, I'm happy to share them with you. And I have a lot of information that I've PRA'd over the years on telco. So I'm happy to share that with whomever.
Yeah, right on, Alice. Your treasure trove of information that has really helped us kind of focus on what's really going on. I mean, we think about it, you know, we say, well, we kind of feel that this is going on. And then your data goes, oh yeah, that actually was going on. That's wild. Yeah. So, all right, Odette, we'll go to you.
Sure. Well, first of all, I wanted to address what Heather was talking about in terms of municipal fiber and municipal broadband. First of all, Chattanooga, in terms of return on investment, exceeded their expectations way beyond it. From 2011 to 2020, they achieved $2.69 billion. It far exceeded their expectations, and it also came, and also the monies came earlier. It created 9,516 jobs, and everything was just beyond their expectations. So it's doable. It's very doable. And also, Chattanooga was not a popular city. It was not a well-maintained city until they decided to turn it around and pick themselves up by their bootstraps. And now it's known as Gig City and has the fastest internet in the United States, and it is attracting technology executives. Okay, that's what resiliency looks like. You create the infrastructure and it attracts, create it and they will come. Right? Anybody heard that? Create
Yes.
it and they will come. All right. And so also in terms of the cows, I know that Alice was talking about cows. There was a French court that closed down a 4G tower because it was killing the cows of this farmer. He had 200 cows and 40 of them died soon after the tower went in, and he got a 20% reduction in milk yield. You know, that can bankrupt a farmer. That's not good. And also in terms of 5G that's required for driverless cars, I'm not really sure what the benefit of driverless cars is, because right now they're employing it in Arizona, in Scottsdale specifically. And from reports that I have heard, people have been killed with these driverless cars. And it's also very dangerous for people who have any kind of sensitivity or who are affected by exposure to wireless radiation. It's very dangerous for them to be around it. It's life-threatening. So I'm not really sure what the benefit of a driverless car is, but in any event, I also wanted to go over something that David Rosen was talking about, and that's Title I and Title II. So right now, we are dealing with federal bills and policy. Now, it's all well and good to have your local ordinance, your zoning ordinance, and have your municipal broadband and try to come up with things that are beneficial for your community. However, there are bills that are now in Congress that will stop that. So H.R. 3557, the American Broadband Deployment Act, preempts local zoning. It gives FCC authority to invalidate local regulations, mandates onerous permitting shot clocks and deemed approved deadlines, and it undermines collaborative federalism. Now that means that there's supposed to be a cooperation between the federal and state governments. Well, it totally overrides the state governments. And it expressly prohibits moratoria. Now in New York City, we got 16 community boards with disapprovals and moratoria, and it's prohibiting that straight out. Now, it did not get bipartisan approval. As a matter of fact, the Democrats were opposed to it. The Republicans voted it out of committee. And the Democrats were opposed to it because it was going to take away local control. Now, H.R. 3557 has not been moving because of that. But what the telecom industry has done is they've taken little bits and pieces of the concepts of 3557, if you will, even if not the exact language. And they're inserting it in must-pass bills. For instance, H.R. 6492, it's a federal lands bill. That passed on a bipartisan basis. It passed the House. It is now in the Senate. Now, of course, people are going to want to support maintaining our trails, maintaining our federal national parks, the recreational areas, of course. However, there is a poison pill in here. Sections 141 and 142 need to be revised in order to take out wireless facilities, because that will blanket our forests with 5G antennas all over the place. And then section 143 deals with authorizing the Department of Interior that can deputize telecom consultants to approve and oversee wireless facilities. Okay, it's not the government anymore necessarily approving and overseeing it. They can delegate it. And so that's the fox guarding the hen house. So one of the witnesses in the House committee, when this was being deliberated, was talking about how important national parks are for children with neurological disorders. The problem is that if we start to proliferate wireless facilities all over the national parks, that will actually provide a high risk of neurological disorders for the children. So it will accomplish the very opposite of what it was intended to do. Then there's HR, so in the Senate, you know, we'd be good to get your senator opposed to that. HR 4510 is the NTIA Reauthorization Act. Now, that is the National Telecommunications and Information Administration. That's the agency that is meeting out the BEAD money. And there's a section, there's a little poison pill there as well. There's a number of poison pills, but the one that I'm going to concentrate on here is Section 405D2, which expressly excludes 5G networks in a cybersecurity study. Now, the former FCC chair, Tom Wheeler, called 5G the most insecure of any of its predecessors. And he actually co-authored an article at the Brookings Institute, I believe it is. And he calls it the 5G cyber paradox, that the more efficient the 5G architecture is, the more insecure it is. That's a problem. And then we've got Senate Bill 4207, Spectrum and National Security Act. Now, this authorizes spectrum and increases the FCC budget. Our ask has been, unless the FCC complies with the 2021 DC Circuit Court of Appeals remand order to review its outdated 1996 wireless emission limits, then FCC's budget should not be increased. Now that should get their attention. And so, Alice, you might like this solution. You know, you want more money in your budget, then you have to comply with a court order. You know, what happens if we as individuals don't comply with a court order? We can go to jail for contempt, right? What's happening to the FCC? It's now 2024. To date, they have not complied. Now, apparently they have until, I think it's 2025 to comply, or 2026, but still, that's 5 years. We don't have 5 years. If we don't comply with a court order within like 5 days, we're going to be pinked. So this is already in the Senate, and we're trying, you know, it would be great if you tell your senator to stop that one as well, unless the FCC complies. And it's a perfectly legitimate request. Now, in terms of net neutrality, and this is going to what David Rosen was saying, the current net neutrality rule otherwise has a very good purpose, and that is to keep the internet free, if you will, and not put artificial restrictions. But what the FCC did is they made broadband service a Title II telecom service, which means that it falls under the FCC preemption. So that means that the FCC has expanded its preemption over local authorities. So if they think that there's a gap in broadband service, boom, you get a 5G tower and you have no say about it. So the Democrats have been supporting the FCC's net neutrality proposed rule. And now they support the rule, which contains the very preemption of local authority that they fought against in HR 3557. So these are the little poison pills that we need to look at. And so, of course, with 5G, is 5G safe? Well, there have been a number of studies. There's been no pre-market testing. We're flying blind, which is what Senator Blumenthal said when he was querying telecom executives in 2019. Of course, in 2011, the WHO's International Agency for Research on Cancer classified wireless radiation, and that was just 2G and 3G, as a possible human carcinogen. And now one of the main scientists there and other scientists are now calling it either a probable or a known human carcinogen. Then, of course, you have the New Hampshire Commission, which found harm, high risk of harm to people and to the environment. And just to see just how risky it is for children, especially since 5G towers have to be so close. And 5G doesn't, it's not just 5G. 5G incorporates 3G and 4G. 4G has a reach of at least 9 miles. If those 3G, 4G, and 5G antennas are really close to you, you're going to get zapped. So look at the five. This is a cell phone held to the ear, and we're looking at this from the top of the head. So now you see the penetration in the 5-year-old child. That's most of his brain. 10-year-old child, and then an adult. And then here is a chart that shows the neurobehavioral symptoms near cell towers. The closer you are to the cell tower, and you see here, if it's less than 10 meters, you see everything in red here, then you have much higher symptoms all across the board. But when you look at this black, these black columns, this black graph, which is more than 300 meters, you still have symptoms, but they're far less. Okay, and so with respect to the FCC emission limits, I think it's important to keep in mind that they, because of their failure to review the 11,000 pages of peer-reviewed scientific studies showing harm below their limits, that their limits are can no longer be viewed as public safety limits. What they're viewed at, what they are a safe harbor for industry. Because as long as industry is operates within the current emission limits, there can be no claim for personal injury or death. And that is under the Telecommunications Act. And there's a provision there that states that as long as they're within the emission limits, that there could be no claim for environmental effects. And the Second Circuit has indicated that environmental effects also includes health effects. I don't know if that is the case with other circuits, but that's the case in the Second Circuit. And so, of course, so with every wireless installation, there's been no pre-market testing for safe levels of emissions, no monitoring of cumulative exposure, and there's no safety zone for either tower collapse or fire. And that's for New York City. There's no protection because there's no setback requirement. And of course, there are public safety hazards. Of course, it can be structural failure, which can make it collapse. But in terms of the fire hazard, does it comply with your electrical and building codes? Now, if it does catch on fire, you cannot put a hose to it immediately. Otherwise, you run the risk of getting electrocuted. So you have to wait up to 60 minutes to cut the power. Otherwise, the firefighters may get electrocuted. And people need time to escape. So if, let's say, this fire is in the forest, and now they have no cell phone communication because the cell tower's on fire. You know, they have to outrun the fire in a forest. I don't know how you do that. And of course, there were these infernos in California in 2007, two in 2007, 2018, 2020, that were caused or contributed to by faulty telecom equipment. The Woolsey fire was the worst in California history, from what I understand. And that caused $6 billion of damages. Almost 100,000 acres were destroyed. 295,000 people had to be evacuated, and there were 3 deaths. And the temperatures can reach in a cell tower when there's a fire up to 35,000 degrees Fahrenheit, which is 3 times the estimated temperature of the sun. And that's what happened in Chula Vista in 2021. I believe it was a 100-foot tower, which became molten plasma. And of course, wireless radiation is considered a pollutant. It is characterized as a pollutant by telecoms in their device protection plans. Just check it out. I think it's probably paragraph 16 or 18 in your protection plan, and it disclaims any injuries. And then the insurance companies also see 5G as off the leash, especially Swiss Re, and they will not insure for personal injury because of the high risk of potential personal injury claims.
The idea that that heat is the only measurement. We got the report from Theodora Scarrato, who had talked about that the FCC standards that define what safety is was primarily or is exclusively based on how hot does it get. And if it doesn't burn you, then it's considered to be safe. Research is out now that if it doesn't burn you, it still causes a disruption in the development of the cells and can create oxidative stress, which has a whole host of issues. Number one, or primarily cancer.
Yeah, it produces biological effects. So even if you don't feel it, it is still doing something to your body. And unfortunately, it gets to a critical mass before you get injured. And then it's either a permanent injury or you can you can resolve it. But, you know, as a matter of fact, just underscoring your point, Larry, there was a patent by Swisscom. They filed for a patent to lower the amount of electromagnetic radiation. And you know the reason that they gave? Because of the high risk of cancer.
And the argument that the wireless industry has used has been, it's safe, it's safe, it's fine, you know, it's no problem. But, you know, it's it, like the one scientist wrote that you cannot measure how hot something gets when it's, that's not what you're trying to get to. It's like, what is the impact to the cells, right? Your cellular composition, how your cells are being developed. That's what you need to measure. And you're saying that just measuring the heat does not accomplish that goal. But there's so much more to that in a report that we could share, you know, after this. I want to take it to David, and then we'll have Heather kind of close out. David?
Well, the only thing, and I had it, but then I lost it. What was interesting to me was our discussions about the community broadband that's actually going on. And we talked about what was going on in Chattanooga, which is a very exciting place. And a couple of years ago, I had written a piece about community broadband, and I went back to it here. And there's Bristol, Tennessee, there's Virginia Beach. And I just went online, just as I was listening, and I'm sure all of you know this, the community network map, you're familiar with this, the community network map. They're saying between 600 and 900 community network services are sort of existing today, which is a considerable number of communities that are beginning to rethink this whole problem. Now, it will take like a miracle to something like this to happen in New York, but let's keep our wishes, you know. But I'm curious in terms of you folks have had far, far more experience working in this world of whether this, you see this as a viable, more and more communities and municipalities around the country see this as a viable option to meet their needs, because obviously the telcos are meeting other needs, which is their investors. So I'm just, I don't really have much more to add other than to try to point out that this is a quite an interesting and substantial movement around the country. And I'm curious, you know, other people's perceptions and how far you think this could go.
That, unless any of my co-panelists have something to say, that actually is a really good segue question for a point that I would like to make. Earlier, I was talking about the role of information literacy and just digital skills in general. And one thing that I had always kind of felt intuitively, but couldn't quantify until I was doing this research and actually found sources stating this, is that not all governments have the same levels of readiness. Some, I would assert that most likely are coastal communities and or those that are east of the Mississippi River are most likely to be more ready. And by ready, I mean having leaders who understand the significance of internet access and all that entails. So understanding the whole picture and having the desire and the motivation to think strategically about how to bring their communities up to speed or get them connected. I don't think all communities are there because the leadership of all communities aren't there. The role of technology and information literacy is often overlooked when it comes to discussions about the digital divide and digital inclusivity and even digital redlining. We often overlook this factor, but often those who work in government, governmental agencies, within libraries, and within schools sometimes have low TIL or low technology and information literacy themselves. Yet they're still the gatekeepers of funds, knowledge, and funding initiatives. So some examples of that, when the ECF was a thing during the 2020 pandemic, I ran across a lot of library leaders and a lot of school superintendents that didn't understand why providing hotspots to students and patrons was important, right? These are the people making the decisions, and they don't understand why internet access is important. The pandemic was good in that it shone a light and it kind of woke some people up. But unfortunately, today, where I'm sitting in Bristow, Oklahoma, we aren't just we're just not ready. We can't be the Utah. We can't be the Chattanooga simply because we don't have enough people who understand. See, Mama from 2020, in a governing article, asserts that governments and telecom cooperatives of rural states have not always led responsibly or assertively to address the connectivity needs of citizens. Unfortunately, from where I sit, this is still a thing in 2024. And so when I confront leaders and I ask these tough questions, a lot of times I get an answer back that I will call toxic positivity. So going back to my Wizard of Oz analogy, you know, I'll point out to somebody at the broadband office and I'll say, hey, you know, that's great that you put fiber in over there in that brand new $1 billion housing development. But meanwhile, I got 50,000 patrons out here on dirt roads that don't have internet connectivity at all. And they've been paying their taxes too. So what gives? So when I bring these things up, I'm also given this sort of answer, right? And it's, oh, Heather, you're just a negative Nancy. Quit being so critical. Look at the internet we put out over there. Look at that rural community over there. They have internet now. And my favorite one is, well, look at what the tribes are doing. Well, arguably the tribes in Oklahoma are only doing something now, or rather, not that they're only doing something now, but these initiatives are only being accessible for tribes now because people like myself and people before me have made these assertions, and now they're being paid attention to. Toxic positivity is a dysfunctional way of managing emotions that involves avoiding, suppressing, or dismissing negative emotions or experiences. It often involves invalidating somebody else's negative emotions or opinions and replacing them with false reassurances or positive suggestions, or even gaslighting. So at best, it's like negligence, right? It's an inability to take responsibility and be accountable. But at worst, it's something more intentional and malicious. Either way, this toxic positivity has got to go. It can exist where there is a leadership vacuum. And in places, unfortunately, like parts of Oklahoma or other states, even California and New York, sometimes there's a leadership vacuum and there are low levels of digital readiness. And I think it's these components that lend to the cycle where these things keep happening.
She's absolutely on point because here locally in California, in the San Gabriel Valley, you know, we have a huge digital divide issue. Just in my own city, my hometown, Pomona, there's 6,000 households that were identified as not having internet access during the pandemic. And we measure that by way of giving them Wi-Fi spots. So the school district, the local community college gave out Wi-Fi spots. So the idea was to keep the kids connected to education. And we found out that, you know, these people did not have internet service. So then we say, okay, great. Let's, you know, the money's here, it's coming down. But then you go to the city council representatives, the elected officials at the city council level, and you say, hey, there's this great opportunity, you know, this money's going to be coming down, let's, you know, let's get going, let's take advantage of it, let's create a mini broadband, let's make it happen. And the elected official will tell you, well, you know, I'm gonna depend on what staff says, you know, it's out of my area, you know, okay, cool, let's see what staff says. So then you go to what staff is saying, and you go to the IT director, the assistant city manager, the city manager, the city planner, you go to all those people, and what do they know about the digital divide? Absolutely zero. They know nothing. They know nothing about the history. That's why, you know, in part, I wanted to do this call today. I thought it was important so we can lay down the tracks of education for the people that are actually worker bees inside the municipal city, inside city halls. Because they are completely unaware. I'll never forget the comment from the IT director of one of our local cities here. I won't mention the specific city, but I mean, he was like, yeah, we're all good. And I was like, that's impossible. How can you say that we are all good? We are not good. There's a giant lack of connectivity. And there's this gigantic trust in the maps, you know, which is another thing that, you know, I was trying to implement was dump the maps, you know, hashtag dump the maps, because the broadband maps that identify who could qualify for these federal dollars and these state dollars are absolutely a farce. They're farcical in nature. They came up, the monopolies themselves said, okay, yeah, this is everybody who has access. So why would, when we're trying to fix the problem that they created, why would we use as the crux of dependence their maps? The challenge process that they've created in California is so cumbersome. There's no way a small city like Pomona or in the San Gabriel Valley would have the resources or the knowledge or anything to even begin the process of challenging those maps. Because first of all, they don't even understand what the digital divide is. You know, you have people that are working in this municipal, in the city that are not from the communities of the digital divide community. Unless you've lived there or work there and work with these people, there's no way you can have an understanding of what that means. And so then you go to the city councilman, again, back to that, you ask him, well, you know, so what do you think? And he goes, well, I talked to my city staff and they're saying we're good. And meanwhile, we have 6,000 people, households in Pomona that are without, right? So it's this big, gigantic, circular problem that perpetuates the lack of leadership that Heather had spoken to. The process, I believe, is we need to educate city staff, the municipalities at a very local level, and have them understand. And then we get to the local elected officials.
I just have one comment on telephone polls. I keep going back there. And I think Odette's presentation and the reflection on polls, it's, I don't think folks realize how important they are and what they represent. And from this perspective of this call, I'll just say, you know, when you look at a telephone pole, the lower lines on the pole are the telecommunication lines, and the higher ones are, of course, the electrical hot wires. Those telco lines, under California rules and regulations and laws, if a telecommunication company doesn't utilize that line anymore, they're supposed to take that down. Well, you and I, if you've ever seen those poles, you know that never happens. It never happens. And so what happens is you get a pole that has this just abundance of weight, and it depletes and takes the poles to a different place, and it makes them fall over and in some cases cause fires. I will tell you this, not one telecommunication company, Odette talked about some fires. Those are real. Those are apps factual, but you never saw that in the press. And I will tell you right now, there are some telecommunication companies that were responsible for contributing to other fires, and they were never called out in the press. And behind the scenes, there was a lot of money going back and forth to make sure that did not happen. And that's, those are, again, awareness. And it's so frustrating because no one stops it and no one cares.
Anyone else on the panel? We'll open it up to the public before we open it up to the public, rather.
I just wanted to give a tangible example to something that Larry was just describing when it on the topic of readiness. And I won't say which place I was employed at. I was employed at a place where ARPA funds were coming down the pike, and the city in which I worked for had kind of dropped the ball on their ARPA application for broadband funds. And so new city administration heard that I might know a thing or two about broadband, but they weren't even sure what broadband was. So the 40 some odd page ARPA application found its way to my desk, and they said, you know, we're not sure if you can handle this or not, but if anybody here can, you can. Can you please get this done? It's on a quick deadline. And I said, okay, all right, what's my deadline? Noon today. It was a 45 page application that once you got to about page 18 or 19, you discovered that you already needed to be doing about 6 to 9 months of data collection and analysis in order to be able to fill out the application in the first place. So I just wanted to use that to kind of paint a picture of why there are some Chattanoogas in the world, but then there's also some other places that just aren't there yet.
Yeah.
I also just wanted to take a second to thank Larry for wrangling this panel. I have learned, it's not often that I actually learn a whole lot while I'm speaking on a panel, but this panel was definitely an exception. I have learned a lot today.
Right on. Very cool. Thank you for that, Heather. David, you wanted to share?
Well, I want to, again, I want to second what you said about Larry. Thank you for putting it together and for inviting me to participate in it. I was sort of dreading it when you asked me, not knowing what I was getting myself into, but it's been a real treat. And the other speakers, I learned a lot also. Thank you very much. I mean, you guys are down in the trenches and I feel like I'm floating in a balloon up here, but thank you so much. It's all been very helpful. But I just wanted to end with something I quote in this book because I'm at the heart a pretty pessimistic guy. I'm going to end with Senator Elizabeth Warren, who's a Democrat from Massachusetts, who's a very strong sort of proponent of some forms of regulation of the phone companies. And she says this, regulatory capture is a big deal. It is one way in which the powerful corporations rig the system to work for themselves and the rest of Americans pay the price. I have more in there, but you have to read the book to get the rest of the quote. But it's the fact that we're up against this enormous, you know, edifice. And I am going back and forth between getting incredibly depressed by our conversations to very enlightened, because I believe that there's a lot of things going on that maybe actually by piece, we can shake up the system and to get something to happen. So I just wanted to share my pessimism with you all. Thank you.
Thank you very much. All right. If nothing else, then we'll go ahead and we'll open it up to the public.
The lawsuit that the regulators brought, this is
you, Mary Beth, can you elaborate? What is your what are you trying to say with the regulators lawsuit?
What they did was to prove that there was fraud by the telecoms, because for years they used the income from local landline service to build the wireless, and they used and they put all the accounting for the whole build out of wireless under the landlines, which was a very insubstantial cost to them. So what happened was they ended up not paying the states the taxes that they were due, and because they could claim that they didn't make a profit because the landline service was bearing the cost of their whole enterprise. So the regulators' lawsuit was trying to prove that in New York and California, and they did that. And then the idea was, okay, you states claim the taxes that you are owed, because it's quite a hefty chunk. Mm-hmm. And but the corruption had gotten, and the control of the telecoms is so enormous that they, I guess, couldn't. Anyway, maybe that's another campaign that we could undertake, just to.
I wanted just to let David. David, did you have some insight on that irregulators lawsuit that Mary Beth is speaking to?
I know about it only in the sense that I get all of Bruce's communications and I speak to him about all this stuff. And I got to be honest with you, I don't remember why the suits actually went nowhere.
No, that's okay. Alice, do you have any recollection of seeing that lawsuit while you were up there?
No, it's ironic though, because I was looking at the exact same thing at the PUC because that was happening. And I was shut down. And I'm wondering what the timing, Mary Beth, what was the timing of that lawsuit?
Look at my records here. Gosh, it was must have been 21. 21.
Okay, so I was fired September of 2020.
You missed a chance.
Yeah.
And it was, no, that's a big, it was a big deal.
Yeah.
Is that,
Yeah, I just
Well,
wanted
Alice, how am I going to be in touch with you? I really.
I have, I'll put my email in the chats. How's that sound?
Okay, great. Thank you so much. And thank you, Larry, for doing this so much.
Absolutely. Odette, go ahead.
Yeah,
I'm sorry,
regarding
Sheila. We'll come back to you, Sheila. Go ahead, Odette.
Regarding the irregulars lawsuit, I'm understanding that the judge ruling was only that the states are able to conduct their own investigation about the accounting that was done by the telecom industry. That even though the accounting that they did was authorized by the FCC, they could be held to a different state standard. So, my understanding that fraud was not determined, that actually the only thing that came out of it, which was what they wanted to come out of it, was that the states were free to investigate.
All right, that's right.
That's right. That's right.
And that's why they there's been no action yet, because a state AG would have to conduct the investigation and someone would have to work with the AG in order to convince them to do that.
Yeah, and then they would pass it to the state auditor who reports to the legislature, and the only other auditing group within the state of California is the Department of Finance, and they report to the governor. So you tell me, do you think either of those agencies are going to do that audit? You got to
So
hire somebody from the outside.
how do we get it to happen? Just more of these education,
Well, you could go to the legislature and request that an outside audit be conducted. And if an outside audit is conducted, it has to be from a somebody that has no affiliation with the state of California, in the sense that they're not being paid off by the state of California. And then they can conduct an audit. And those are the I hired an independent audit firm to come in and do three audits. They ended up doing five for me. Every single one of those audits had, I would say, egregious findings. One of the auditors said to me he'd never seen anything so bad in his entire career, and he'd been an auditor for 25 years. Go
Yeah,
figure.
so maybe if it's told in story form and it's written up in a short article and we can ed educate people. I mean, the states have what, millions, many millions to collect.
Yes,
Right.
billions.
But I would say we're probably in the billions.
Billions, if you believe Bruce's numbers.
So the thing is that, so the motivation for the state to investigate is that this was already paid for by the ratepayers, and that now they need to claim their money back. So that is, and so that is the story that needs to be told to the legislature, to the electeds, to the governor, to say, yeah, you want fiber? You don't have to pay a dime.
That's
Conduct,
right.
you don't have to pay a dime. Conduct this investigation and it'll be all paid for. You go into a settlement agreement for billions of dollars and they have to pay you back all the money, all the ratepayer monies that they took.
But
And
all
that's
right,
how you
so
do it. That's how, so actually it would be a great idea to do a video for the electeds, Mary.
no.
I think that the as I shared, we took this up the flagpole with the state's assembly majority leader, who came back.
You did? You did?
Yes,
You already did this.
we talked to her personally, and we had a group in front of her last year. Superintendent, city mayors, and she no appetite whatsoever, which led me to believe, again, you know, the nonprofit organizations in her region were all bought off. So see, it's very systematic. So you buy off, you have to buy off public opinion, and you do that by supporting the nonprofit organizations, the key ones, the leaders, right? The Boys and Girls Club, the you know, the cancer cures, the homeless, you know, all of these agencies that, you know, are prominent in these regions. Corporations will come in, they'll give them money. Now they have to walk and talk the talk of the corporations. And so when the politician, the elected official, the state majority leader asks the question, hey, is this what's going on? And they're going to say, oh, no, we're good. You know, we're good. You know, AT&T is fantastic, you know. And those are kind of the talk points that happen. So strategizing within this group and the outcome of what we have here in terms of how do we penetrate that piece right there to get the side of public opinion on our side to have it just be a greater general understanding. Also, again, back to, you know, Heather's point of the actual staff within the municipalities being undereducated and not understanding what's going on, that, you know, leads back to the elected official saying, so, you know, it's part of that whole kind of education campaign. Does anyone else want to say anything on that note? Then I'll get to Sheila.
Yeah, the other thing I will add, Larry, is that the president of the commission at the time that I was terminated is now consulting for some of the telecommunication companies. I don't see a connection.
Oh God.
That is expected. And maybe there's your story, David. There's your revolving
door. No, that's what it is. I mean, for sure. Hey, well, don't worry. I got a lot of stories here. Oh, it's Scandalville, USA. I mean, this is just right. Now, Bruce, I should also add that Bruce, I have to take my hat off. I wish it was on this thing. I'd give him a big hug. But he has pushed this thing in Rhode Island, and he got to a certain point that it just sort of dissipated, but he thought he had some traction. He also, there's a New York City councilman, state assemblyman, who has been supportive, and who knows? He
who
may
that?
Bring this up.
Who
I'm sorry?
Who is that?
Gibbs, you know, a guy. I think that's what his name is, Gibbs. But you can talk to Bruce and get it. It's better than me, please. But he's expressed, according to Bruce, he's expressed interest in pursuing this issue. So
yeah, it's hard. I think it's hard for any elected official. And going back to, you know, my state majority leader of the assembly example, we've been friends for 30 years. And there's just, you know, so much pressure, money, you know, pressure equals money, to keep the status quo in place.
Yeah.
It has to come from us, you know, your friends, our friends, and to the point of like, okay, what's the outcome? Well, you as the elected officials, you don't get to get elected if you're not going to take up this issue. You know, we're not going to support you. And, you know, they try to say, oh, well, we're doing all this other good stuff around, you know, the toxic positivity that Heather talks about. Okay, let's turn it to Sheila. You have back to your question, Sheila. Go ahead.
Yeah, thanks. So what you've all just been discussing about the regulator's lawsuit was exactly what I wanted to get at. And I mentioned that some colleagues and I spoke to the environmental unit at the Rhode Island Attorney General's office several years ago and tried to interest them in doing something in regard to what the regulators had done in New York and got nowhere. So now I'm really interested in what David just mentioned, that Bruce had been speaking to someone in Rhode Island. And if I could find out more about who that is.
I can get your email.
Yeah.
I can hook you up with, do you know Bruce?
Well, I know of him. I know of his work. Yes. And
yeah,
so
I can hook you up with Bruce and he'll tell you the story.
Great. That's great. Because this is what I wanted to know is, you know, what repercussions have there been anywhere? Have other states taken this up and tried to get their money back? Because people have been paying for years, supposedly to get the fiber to the premises, and the money was basically embezzled by the telecoms to put into wireless.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Yeah, we all understand that to be true. All right, let's go ahead and let's do a wrap now. Go around, round robin. We'll start with you, Alice. Closing remarks, and where do we go from here? and then we'll wrap it. Go ahead.
Again, Larry, thank you for putting this together. This was really informative. I learned a lot today. And I hope we can do this again and get better and progress. I think accountability for me is the key. And I really appreciated Heather, Odette, and David's presentations today. And I also appreciated all the questions. So thank you.
Terrific. All right. Thank you very much. Odette?
Yes, I have to say that I was so impressed with my co-panelists. Just excellent. I've learned so much. And it really is so great to meet similarly minded people and to have some synergies, because I think some synergies have already come out of this endeavor. And I definitely think that if we start perhaps a letter writing campaign in each state to the Attorney General, Attorneys General, and to say, this is a situation. And you know, we can do this on a national basis. It could be the same form letter. It can be, and we can have lots of people just send the letter to the AG's office and start the process and start the conversation with our representatives to get that going. And I think that's really kind of a low-hanging activity that could be really easily done. That doesn't require a lot of work. So that's very important. And also, we're involved in a project where we're going to be sending out to letters to the Attorneys General about the 2021 decision that the FCC failed to comply with.
Good.
I think the estate AGs are going to be very interested.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm now working with one of our advocates on the national call in order to get that done. That's really important. And then, you know, of course, the outreach. And Mary is a great producer and movie producer, and it would be great to get more videos out. National call.
Awesome. So,
and thank you very much for putting this together, Larry. I really learned a lot. This was a great session.
Awesome. Yeah. Thank you. All right. David?
I'm first of all, meeting you all is the best part of this whole conversation, because I realize I live in my own little bubble, and I know the guys in the regulators, and I know Bruce, and I sort of follow it from that distance. But seeing your involvements, all of you, in terms of the different ways you're playing this out is fantastic, because it gives me some real hope that something can happen. So anyway, I've got an idea for a story, and what I'd like to call the fix is in. And I would appreciate it if Larry could actually just send maybe everybody, but the email addresses for each of us. I think I may even have some of you, so that I can actually reach out to you for quotes, because I realize that in pitching this to various publications, I need to use individuals as resources. I mean, so the idea is an article called The Fix Is In, and it uses, I think, California as a test case to show how the racket works in terms of one person's experiences. And that's you, Alice. But it uses you all, because you all add to how the fix works and how it works across the country. So thank you.
All right, David, thank you for that. Yeah, absolutely. There'll be shorts that I'm going to put together. I'm not sure if you had a chance to see any of the ones I did as far as intro pieces. We're going to do this. I'm going to do this all day long. There's going to be a lot of gems, just your commentary, you guys. I've already articulated that learned so much. There's a lot of gems that have come out of this conversation, and I really appreciate, you know, so we'll be in constant contact. We'll do a group mail and y'all will be copied on it. So we'll continue to share this information as the information is published and, you know, emails, et cetera. Heather?
I think the only thing that I really would like to just conclude with is that we're all only human, and you don't know what you don't know. And people who don't live and work in the realms of access and why access is important don't really think about access being important. We're all guilty of it, right? We all flip on and off the light switch. Heck, we're all signed on to this Zoom meeting. So there's a whole lot that we take for granted. If we could go back in a time machine to 100 years ago when public utilities were being installed across the United States, I think perhaps we would all benefit and be thinking about these things, and they would be on the forefront of our minds. But unfortunately, time travel hasn't happened yet. And most of the public at large, if they already are connected, they're not thinking about those who aren't. So I think we need to figure out a way to change that. And I think Odette is 100 spot on when it comes to doing public service announcements and doing other videos and other informatics. Larry, you said it yourself, just educating people and really tying in how it affects us all as a society. If all of us don't have access to basic resources and utilities like the internet, then it affects us all. Here's also hoping for some Netflix documentary or somebody to pick this topic up and make it more publicly accessible.
Yes. All right, Heather, I 100% agree with that. I really, really appreciate your time and your wisdom that you brought forth on this panel. That was, it's just simply amazing. And I can't wait to get to the shorts and start cutting up the little gems that that we got out of this. I really, really appreciate all y'all's participation, and to all the guests who on the line and also stayed on, you know, very much appreciate you being a part of this conversation, and we want you to share, you know, with everyone. And much gratitude to all of you. Once again, thank you very, very much. This is a spectacular event. Really appreciate your participation, and we'll see you next time.